Don't forward the video for first 1.5 minutes. The biggest challenge that we YouTubers have is to set a context for a particular topic. Now, when I start the concept of bail, I cannot just start because I'm not going to complete all the aspects of bail in one video. So you might be feeling upset after watching this video because your expectation must be something different. So what I thought is I will explain my thinking way first so that you can align according to my classes. Now, there are four important sections when it comes to bail under CRPC, that is section number 436 to 439. This entire concept is discussed under chapter 33 of CRPC, which is from section 436 to 450, which is discussing about bails and bonds. And 436, 437, 438 and 439, all are very important sections which are dealing with bail for bailable offense, bail for non-bailable offense, the anticipatory bail and the special powers, and there can be independent question on each topic. So what I decided, I will take each classes in a different classes so that I can cover the entire concept along with case laws. In my first video, I am going to cover section 436 and the background and meaning of bail so that you have introduction for all the answers. So that is how I am going to explain. I hope that makes sense. Hey guys, welcome to my legal classes. This is Ganesh Pujari. So let's get into the class of bail under bailable offenses. Let us start the discussion by understanding the meaning of bail. And before getting into the meaning, I would like to give a brief history of bail. From when do we have this concept of bail? You will get shocked if I say about 2420 years itself we had the concept of bail. But it is true that Plato tried to create a bond for the release of Socrates. And the current bail is shaped with the series of laws originating in the Middle Ages in England. Now, meaning is defined under section 2A of CRPC. Now, whether it is a meaning or categorization, let us try understand after reading it. Bailable offenses means an offense which is shown as bailable in the first schedule or which is made bailable by any other law for the time being in force, and non-bailable offenses means any other offense. Now, is this meaning? I don't agree. This is basically categorization. Whatever is mentioned in first schedule or any other different law as bailable offenses, they are bailable offenses. And if the first schedule is not talking anything on that or any other law is not considering that as bailable offense, then they'll be considered as non-bailable offense. Now, that is not the meaning. Now, to try understand the meaning, I have brought one more aspect. Let's read out procedure by which a judge or magistrate sets at liberty one who has been arrested or imprisoned upon receipt of security to ensure the released prisoner's later appearance in court for further proceedings. There are five important aspects you need to remember. One, this is the procedure set up by judge or magistrate. Second one, for what? To give liberty to a person. To which person? Who has been arrested or imprisoned. That is the third aspect. Fourth one, with what? Receipt of security. Fourth one, to confirm what? Prisoner's later appearance in court. These are the five important aspects you need to remember while writing the meaning of bail. With that, I'm going to the next slide. Now, the next question is, what are the important sections when it comes to bail? Now, it is very important for you to decide whether you are going to write the sections in the exam or not. The moment you write sections in your exam, the subject becomes scientific. You cannot make any mistake. So decide before itself whether you are going to study the sections and write in exam or not. Don't risk it at the last moment. And if you write wrong sections, you are gone. Now, chapter 33 of CRPC has four important sections as far as bail is concerned. And the first section for bail is coming in chapter 2 itself in the form of section 2A. Which defines bailable and non-bailable offense. Whether it defines or not, that is a question mark. You cannot write that in exam hall. Now, the four sections that are dealt in chapter 33 are section 436, which is dealing with bail in the case of bailable offenses. Section 437 deals with bails in the case of non-bailable offenses. Section number 438 deals with anticipatory bail, and section 439 deals with power to session court and high courts in granting bail. These are the four important sections that you need to remember because all of them can be independent questions. So what I'm going to do in this session is I'm explaining section 436 in detail along with the case laws, and I'll be making independent videos on all the other sections. With that, let's move to the next two slides, which are discussing about section 436, that is bail in the cases of bailable offenses. One important trick that you need to remember when you write on bailable or non-bailable or cognizable and non-cognizable, the relationship between these concepts. The concept how to remember, I also thought for a many time like getting confused and we have to clarify it to the students. So this is the trick finally I came with. Like when one concept is small, the other one becomes long, and when the first concept is long, the other one becomes small. For example, bailable offense, non-cognizable offense, and non-bailable offense, cognizable offense. They are a team, like one becomes small and one becomes long. So that's how you need to remember. Now, a bailable offense is also a non-cognizable offense, and for both of them, the punishment is less than 3 years. And non-bailable offenses are cognizable offenses also, and for them, the punishment is more than 3 years. That one thing you need to remember. Now, here what happens, there are five important aspects when it comes to section 436. When a person, he is coming in front of a police or a magistrate, and let's try understand in the context of that particular person. He is accused, but he is not accused of any non-bailable offenses. That means he has not committed any cognizable offenses. If such person is being, that is number one, accused. Second one, he may be arrested or he may be detained. So that is the number two you need to remember. Number three, after arrested or detained, he may be brought in front of the court or he himself has come in front of the court. Both options are there under number three. Four, he shall be released on bail. So when I say shall, I have kept all the letters in capital because it is not an option. Court shall give or release him on bail. That is the right that he is having. That is why we call section 436 as mandatory bail also. Now, what is the number five? If indigent, that means he is not affordable to pay any security or he couldn't bring any surety, in that case also he need to be released with self surety. That is the important aspect you need to remember. So these are the 5 points, and if you remember them, you are done. But there is two exceptions. If the person is accused of section 116.3, which is on public tranquility of IPC, and 446A, that is coming under CrPC, which is cancellation of breach of bond or bail. These two are the exceptions. Otherwise, for all those 5 points, whatever I have mentioned, such thing will be a bailable offense and that guy will definitely get a bail. With that, let's move on. I said section 436 is mandatory bail. That means court cannot refuse, but that doesn't give ultimate power to the person who has been accused. Now, in the first case, they will do what? They will put conditions in the bail bond saying that on certain time and date and place, the person has to come for attendance. And if he is missing such time and place, in the future occasion, if he commits a similar offenses, which is bailable offense, the court has the power to decline because he has already breached the condition of bail once, and they can also put penalty under section 446 of CrPC. So this is the power available with the court to refuse bail in bailable offenses. And section 436A discusses about release on own surety, that means self surety. After serving 50% of the punishment, one can apply for bail. But the exception for that is the one who is serving death punishment cannot apply for bail under this particular section. The three important case laws that you can refer for bail for bailable offenses: Motiram versus State of UP, where the court said the amount of bail should not be too high. In the second case, that is Sanjay Chandra versus CBI, principal purpose of bail is to ensure that the accused will return for trial if he is released after arrest. That means he cannot miss the trial after releasing on bail. So that is the principal purpose of bail. And the last case that you can refer is State of Rajasthan versus Balchand, where provision of bail is to restore the liberty of the arrested person. Bail is given for what? To restore the liberty of the arrested person, which was discussed in this particular case. That brings an end to this particular topic, that is bail for bailable offenses. I am going to see you in my next class, which is on bail for non-bailable offenses, which is very interesting, where I am going to discuss the principle by Supreme Court also with sufficient case laws. Thank you so much for watching me. Please subscribe and please like, share and comment my videos, and all the very best for your exams or whatsoever purpose you are watching this video. Thanks again.